by 2050, according to the UN, there may be up to 1 billion forcibly displaced people crossing borders around the world due to climate change. You guys are located in India. I don't have to remind you how India, especially places like Chennai, are already being hit very badly by extreme temperatures, and people will have to, if we don't do enough now, we'll have to leave their homes in a couple of decades. So in this context, because the failure is so spectacular, this needs and warrants more urgent approaches by courts.
Are courts bastions of change? That's sort of the question we're looking at in the context of crisis.
Kind of a classic question in, of course, in public interest law, but also in socio-legal studies on courts. And something that I've done, as you just said, RP, is bring some lessons from other fields of advocacy and litigation, for example, socioeconomic rights, to bear on the open-ended and urgent questions about whether courts have any meaningful and useful role in precisely kind of expediting and scaling up action against this existential threat of climate change. The short answer is yes, but it is also a qualified answer. So what I've been trying to do in my recent work is specify those conditions. Well, try to figure out exactly what type of litigation, exactly what type of advocacy, exactly what type of jurisprudence could be most helpful to contribute in terms of contributing to the work of many individuals and organizations around the world that are mobilizing on the streets, or scientists who are figuring out the details of the attribution science, meaning how much more likely extreme weather events are due to climate change, due to global warming, climate change. So this is by no means a problem that can be tackled solely or even mainly by lawyers or let alone by judges. But from an ecosystemic view, and one thing that I am keen to do is to shift from the usual metaphors and concepts of the social sciences that have always, especially economics, that have been using and drawing on concepts and modes of thinking from mechanics, from physics, from and move more towards an ecosystemic and ecologically inspired intellectual framework. And from that point of view, we need to think of climate change and human rights and activism and litigation in terms of an ecosystem, right? And in that ecosystem, there are many species doing their thing. Scientists are doing what they need to do. Journalists are doing their part. And in this context, it is helpful and I think very important to ask, well, exactly what can lawyers, activists, and courts do? And the short answer that I gave in my recent work is we need to use courts as prods. There's a great article by a professor at Yale Law School, Doug Kaiser, who uses the metaphor of prods and pleas, right? Courts cannot impose solutions or come up with the science. They're not policymakers, but they're not climate experts. But they certainly have been historically extremely helpful, and that's actually the role that I see for them, as prods for other actors like government officials to do what is needed when they are failing to do their part. So in this realm of climate action, the problem is that governments have spectacularly failed at doing their part, right? So if you look at, for example, the emission gaps report put together by UN bodies every year, we're nowhere near where we need to be if we're to have a chance of avoiding even the most catastrophic scenarios of climate change. For instance, just to give you a couple of numbers, by 2050, according to the UN, there may be up to 1 billion forcibly displaced people crossing borders around the world due to climate change. You guys are located in India. I don't have to remind you how India, especially places like Chennai, are already being hit very badly by extreme temperatures, and people will have to, if we don't do enough now, will have to leave their homes in a couple of decades. So in this context, and this is kind of the last bit of my answer, because the failure is so spectacular, this needs and warrants more urgent approaches by courts. So not irresponsible approaches, not this is not a free for all, but certainly in terms of concepts, in terms of litigation strategies, in terms of court injunctions, this is a moment where we need to use all the tools of our imagination. And some courts and some activists and some litigants are using them in an increasingly proactive way. So as prods for action, and also as sources of pleas to government, pleas to public opinion, in order to raise awareness about how urgent the situation is, how dire the impact on human rights and the life of other species on the planet. This is the anthropocentrism of human rights is part of the problem here, but this is one of the roles that I think courts can play. And if they can also create some sort of transmission belt, of conveyor belt, between what international science recommends, say, for example, the IPCC report, and what governments are promising to do in those kind of lofty declarations in Paris or this year in Glasgow, and what they actually do on the ground in their own countries. So if courts can also turn those eloquent but ultimately inconsequential pledges into binding commitments that governments can be held accountable to in domestic courts, then you start seeing a very helpful role for courts and litigation that no other mechanism and no other institution can meaningfully play at this point in democratic societies with independent court systems.